This session, what we want to talk about is visualization and imagination. Maybe that sounds like a strange topic, but I think you'll understand as we get into it how very, very important it is. And I hope you're beginning to get a picture. We're dealing with man and God, basically. That's what we've got. And man was made in the image of God, made for God, made to find his fulfillment in God. And you know what happened? He turned from God to himself. And that was because of the seduction of Satan, who said, "I will be like the Most High," and who then deceived Eve. And you could analyze the whole situation. Everything that Satan is trying to do, all of his techniques, are to turn us from God, from the true God, to a substitute, the Star Wars force, some higher power, to turn us from true faith to some subconscious power of the mind, and ultimately to turn us to ourselves, to find our fulfillment in ourselves, to find a potential within. And if you keep that framework in mind, I think you'll understand better what the Bible is talking about and what Satan is trying to do and what we're trying to share with you. I want to read just a few letters. Well, I think I'm only going to, well, maybe a couple of them here we'll have time for. The first one is a letter that came to me from a young man in the Pittsburgh area, very concerned. We get lots of these letters. He said, "In early August, a pastor from New York gave two teachings in our fellowship. I felt there were numerous errors in his interpretations, and he spoke of many of his beliefs as if they were Bible facts. There were references to concepts such as visualization, sanctified imagination, mind's eye, unconscious, incubation, synchronization, holograms, third and fourth dimension, and so forth, concepts whose meaning and applicability received little scriptural justification." And he goes on to say how he discussed this, or tried to discuss it, with the pastor. He thought there were some things that were not right. And he tried to discuss it with the pastor and with this man who had come, and they said he didn't have formal theological education and training, and therefore he wasn't competent. You know, that's one of the things that people sometimes say to me. Who are you to question these great men of God? You don't have a degree in theology. Well, but I'm a Berean. The Bereans didn't have a degree in theology. But the Bereans searched the scriptures daily to see whether Paul was telling them what was according to the Word of God. And I have the right to do that, and you have the right, not only the right to do that, we have the responsibility to do that. And then in order to educate him a bit, they gave him a book by Dennis Waitley, Seeds of Greatness, and another one by Morton Kelsey, The Other Side of Silence. And we've already talked about Morton Kelsey. He will lead you right into occultism. He's a Jungian, and we'll get more into that when we talk about psychology. We've mentioned Norman Vincent Peale, 33rd degree Mason, a man who kept alive in the church these ideas that came out of New Thought. New Thought, the power is in your mind, and who wrote The Power of Positive Thinking, who equates positive mental attitude with faith and brings confusion into the Church of Jesus Christ. I was on the radio some time ago, and the man who was interviewing me wanted to straighten me out on this topic of positive mental attitude, which I'm very happy to be straightened out on. If you correct me, I wouldn't consider it to be an attack. I would consider it a kindness. He said, "You're against positive mental attitude." Now, I'll tell you, why am I against positive mental attitude? Anyone who knows me would tell you that you would never find me down, never depressed, never discouraged, no matter what the situation. But I wouldn't give you 2 cents for a positive mental attitude. But I'm rejoicing because I'm in his hands. I'm trusting him, not some mental attitude. You understand what I'm trying to say? And people are trying to get a mental attitude to bring them out of depression. Well, what they need is to turn to the Lord. If you create a mental attitude that's not based upon reality, you are deceiving yourself. But if you get to know him and have faith in him, then he will change your attitude based upon the truth, not based upon mental manipulations. And he said, I think that the Bible is the foremost positive mental attitude book in the world. What do you think of that? I said, well, I don't want to embarrass you on radio. And he said, well, go ahead. So I said, well, you can get out your Strong's Exhaustive Concordance and you can look it up. You won't find the word positive, you won't find the word mental, and you won't find the word attitude. Now, doesn't it seem a bit odd that the foremost positive mental attitude book in the world doesn't even know this concept? You didn't discover it from reading the Bible. You got the idea out there, and then you brought that idea to the Bible to try to find some justification for it. And the church is filled with concepts like that, that were not learned by men and women of God studying the Bible on their knees, but were gotten out there in the world, and then were brought into the church and tried to dress them up in biblical language and justify them. Norman Vincent Peale is a man who has brought concepts from the occult, from the mind sciences, from psychology, and has tried to dress them up in biblical language and pass them off as Christianity. In his new magazine, Plus, the magazine of positive thinking, May 1986, he had an article where he refers to Marilyn Helleberg. She wrote a book called Beyond TM, Transcendental Meditation, A Practical Guide to the Lost Tradition of Christian Meditation. He says, Marilyn Helleberg suggests a meditation in which you visualize a white mist filled with myriads of little points of energy that gleam like diamonds. Scientists say this is the life substance, the life force, this creative energy beyond that which we consciously experience. Visualize this mist high above you, around you, cascading down, a scintillating light. Then deeply breathe in the white mist and visualize it as proceeding upward into your throat, into your nasal passages, into your brain, vitalizing, sharpening, and quickening your mind, making it alive with a new power filled with light and wonderment. He says, I've been practicing this type of meditation for several days, and I can report that after using it only a half dozen times, one begins to feel different. Now we're going by feelings. It induces a sense of vital energy and awareness of God's presence. Then he says, who is God? Some theological being? He's so much greater than theology. God is vitality. God is life. God is energy. As you breathe God in, as you visualize his energy, you will be re-energized. What does that have to do with the Bible? What does that have to do with knowing Jesus Christ? What does that have to do with the redemptive work of Christ upon the cross? What does that have to do with Christ being the true vine and we're branches in him? What does that have to do with Christ becoming my life and knowing the true God? It has nothing whatsoever to do with it. It's a psychological technique. You're being deluded into feeling that you're getting in touch with God by visualizing some energy and breathing it in. It's a technique. And one thing that we must beware of is techniques to get to know God, to get in touch with God. Because as soon as you become proficient at the technique, then you think you've gotten to know God. If you think you can visualize Jesus, you become proficient at visualizing Jesus, you think you've gotten to know Jesus, and you haven't. And we'll talk more about that as we get into our subject. In Charisma, January 1986, a regular feature in there, Poolside Protection by Leonard LeSueur. He was married to Catherine Marshall. He says, over the years, my late wife Catherine and I learned never to begin any travel without praying in this particular way. We did more than just ask for God's help. We visualized him sending his protecting angels to ride with us. And then he goes on and talks about what you've got to do when you pray for protection. You've got to visualize an angel riding shotgun on the bumper. And then you have protection. Where does it say that in the Bible? What does visualization have to do with this? Are we helping God through our visualization? These are some of the teachings that are coming into the Church of Jesus Christ. I have a newsletter from Kenneth Copeland that came out early in 1986. He has a picture of himself standing in front of his prayer cabin. And then he suggests that he enclosed that picture here in the newsletter, and he suggests that you look at this picture. And he says there are going to be times when he's in prayer where the power of God is going to come upon him that will be more than sufficient to meet your needs. And if you could only be there and he could touch you, then that power would flow to you. But since you're not there, the best thing you can do is touch his photograph and visualize yourself. He says, visualize yourself. As you visualize yourself there with me, remember there's no time or distance in the realm of the Spirit. He says, this is very important. What does visualization have to do with truth? It involves my imagination. I am creating something. Let's consider, just carefully, what's going on here. Now, visualization is a natural ability that human beings have. If you are an architect or an engineer, or you're reading a novel, you see in your mind the scene that is being painted by the novelist. There's nothing wrong with that. I remember as a little boy, we could draw on the ground in the dirt, and that was a room. And then we made a house and so forth. And you have a great imagination. And that's part of growing up as a child. But if when you get into your late teens and your 20s and 30s, you still are playing with imaginary playmates, and you still are retreating into the imaginary world. I've had to counsel with people like this in their 30s, who, when they faced something in the real world that they couldn't handle, they retreated into this world within, that they could create in their imagination. Now understand some things. We're not even talking about occultism now. We're talking about the dangers of the imagination. You can begin to confuse the imaginary world with the real world. And you begin to retreat into this instead of facing what's out there. And then you begin to think that you can manipulate that world by what you do in this imaginary world. And what are you in this imaginary world? You are God. You have achieved those very powers that Eve grasped for. You can arrange the characters on the stage, and you can make yourself the hero or the heroine. I remember as a little boy, I used to walk to that grammar school, and I can remember thinking of myself, seeing myself as a knight in armor on a white horse with a flashing sword riding into that school ground, and I'm going to straighten out a few people, particularly some teachers, you know. You are deceiving yourself. We used to say, oh, it didn't really happen, you just imagined it. Imagination today is the new therapy. You fantasize, you visualize, you role play, and you adjust the way you think of your past or whatever by changing your thinking through visualizing and fantasizing in your mind. It's part of a delusion. It's part of a retreat from reality. And it's related to the Hindu belief in Maya, M-A-Y-A, which says there is no reality out there. We have created it with our minds. And you created your own world, you created your own problems, and all you have to do is change your thinking, change your perception, the way you perceive reality. It's called avidya in Hinduism. There's no sin, there's no moral accountability. It's a flaw in your perception, and you need to change the way you look at things and change your perception, and then that changes everything. Now, you can take another step, and you move into the occult. If you imagine that you can manipulate reality, that you can create reality with your mind, that if you visualize something, you can eventually, if you get a clear enough image, bring it into existence. And there's that teaching. In the occult, there have always been three techniques for what we call mental alchemy. You know, the alchemists tried to find a formula, some method, for changing base metals into precious metals. But mental alchemy is even more powerful. You can create your own universe with your mind if you know how to tap into it. And there were three techniques: thinking, positive thinking, speaking a mantra, speaking it forth. But the most powerful occult technique is visualization. And the shamans, we've talked a bit about shamanism. The witch doctors have always known that there is a mysterious power in the imagination, and that if you visualize certain things, you can make contact with the spirit world. And any witch doctor, any shaman will tell you the fastest way to pick up a spirit guide is to go on what they call the shamanic journey. And the shamans in their mind go on a journey into the past or into the future. They go to what they call the upper world or the lower world, and they visualize an entity, and they make contact with a spirit guide. And you can pick up a demon very quickly if you get involved in this sort of thing. If you think that you can visualize Jesus, that you can visualize God, and you can have Christ right there when you want him, then you have moved into the occult. You will make contact with something. Guarantee that you will make contact with something. But it will not be of God. It is the fastest way to get in touch with the spirit world. Now, unfortunately, these ideas are being taught in the Church of Jesus Christ today. This is a book by Richard Foster. It's called Celebration of Discipline. It's been a big selling book in Christian bookstores. Let me just read you something and try to show, and I believe I've talked with Dr. Foster. He's a very sincere Christian man. I think he's been led astray, and I think he's leading other people astray, and I think we've got to analyze what's happening very carefully and get back to the Word of God. But he says, Christian writers throughout the centuries have spoken of a way of listening to God, of communing with the Creator of heaven and earth, of experiencing the eternal lover of the world. There's a way to do it, he says. There is a technique for doing this, he says. Scripture tells us that John was, quote, in the Spirit on the Lord's day when he received his apocalyptic vision. Could it be that John was trained in a way of listening and seeing that we have forgotten? Now you see the implication? It wasn't that God sovereignly chose John and chose John as the one through whom he would bring a revelation of the future. And God moved upon him, God initiated it, and it was for God's purposes, but it was that John was schooled in a technique for getting in touch with God. And that was how he got this revelation. And what we need to do is learn this technique ourselves, so that knowing God and getting in touch with God involves a technique. But the Bible would absolutely refute that. Knowing God is something much deeper than this. And it is something that is vitally important for us, because Jesus himself said, "This is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent." And how do you know God? Well, Richard Foster goes on, and he says that the imagination is what is important. Anyone who can tap the power of the imagination can learn to meditate. Now, it doesn't have anything to do with reality, but it has to do with imagination and visualization and what we create from within ourselves. He says what we need to do is to take time to explore the inner regions. I'm reading from page 16. Now you see, instead of getting to know God, we're going to get to know ourselves, and we will see that more when we get into psychology. Psychology is the study of man. It's not the study of God, but it obsesses us with self. And we go into the depths of our psyches, and we begin to analyze how we act and so forth. It turns us from God to self. And this is turning us from the inspiration and the revelation of God to originate something within ourselves and to explore what he calls the inner regions. Then he tells us on page 18, how then do we come to believe in a world of the spirit? Is it by blind faith? Not at all. The inner reality of the spiritual world is available to all who are willing to search for it. So we begin to look within ourselves, we begin to visualize and so forth. Now, he says the inner world of a meditation is most easily entered through the door of the imagination. We fail today to appreciate its tremendous power. The imagination is stronger than conceptual thought, stronger than the will. He says we've turned to rationalism in the West, but we need to get back into visualization, into fantasy, and into imagination. Then he tells us that the way to understand, for example, what Jesus was really teaching, let's say when Jesus pushed out in Peter's boat out from the shore a little ways and spoke to this crowd at the Sea of Galilee, if you want to understand, don't just read the words in the Bible, but you visualize in your mind. He says, seek to live the experience, smell the sea, hear the lap of water along the shore, see the crowd, feel the sun on your head, the hunger in your stomach, taste the salt in the air, touch the hem of his garment. All of the things which, had you been there that day and concentrated upon them, would have kept you from hearing what Jesus was saying. But he's leading us down the primrose path of believing that if we can somehow create in our minds a vivid scene of how we imagine it might have been, that we will thereby gain deep insight into what Jesus was teaching. You could have been there that day. You could have heard him with your physical ears and missed everything that Jesus said. John's Gospel, chapter 8, we haven't looked at the scriptures. Let's take a look there, first of all, and see what Jesus said. Verse 43, why do you not understand my speech, even because you cannot hear my word? Well, they were hearing his word, but they were not understanding. You know why Jesus said, finished every letter to the seven churches in Asia in the first few chapters of Revelation? He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Jesus quoted Isaiah when he said to the people of his day, having eyes, you see not, having ears, you hear not. The Word of God tells us, Hebrews chapter 11, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And they're trying to tell us we're going to get faith if we can somehow see it, if we can somehow see Jesus. Or Paul Yonggi Cho would tell you, and Richard Foster says the same thing, if you're praying for a sick person, if you can somehow visualize that person well in your mind, see them as a well person, then you will have the faith to believe. That's not faith in God. That's faith in the power of my mind. That's not faith that sees the invisible. That's faith that relies on what it can see and conjures up something in order to get faith, which is the opposite of what the Bible says. It is the evidence of things not seen. We're told of Moses, he endured as seeing him who is invisible. That God is invisible, he dwells in a light that no man can approach unto. But these people are trying to visualize God and thinking that that will draw them into a relationship with him, and they're missing the point entirely. Elijah on the mountain, for example, learned that God didn't speak in the wind, although it was so strong that it broke rocks. He was not in the earthquake, he was not in the fire, but he spoke with a still, small voice that could be heard only by those who knew him, who belonged to him, who were submissive to him. And so Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. You get to hear his voice by being one of his sheep, not by trying to conjure him up in your mind. And we're being led from the spiritual reality to a fantasy that we have conjured up in our minds. I was speaking about this, and a very sincere pastor came up to me afterwards, and he said, well, you know, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. And people often say that, particularly when I'm talking about psychology. I have sort of a standard response. I say, well, tell me about the baby. I've never found anybody that can tell me about the baby yet. I say, I have strained the water and I can't find the baby. But if there's a baby there, it's Rosemary's baby. Well, he said, look, I've been visualizing myself in the presence of God. When I pray, I found that it gives me a closer relationship with the Lord. It has strengthened my faith. Now, what could be wrong with that? That's pragmatism. If it works, it must be okay. Oh, people have had their lives transformed by transcendental meditation, by yoga, by hypnosis, by all kinds of things. The question is it true? See, that's what I don't like about, is it positive? Positive and negative sounds like electricity. It has nothing to do with the real issue. The real issue is it true or false? Is it biblical or not biblical? And all this talk about, oh, but it's so positive. What do you mean by positive? What you mean is what's pleasing to you, what you would like. But it has nothing to do with truth. It has nothing to do with the real issue. You see? And so it works. But I feel better, says Norman Vincent Peale, when I visualize this mist and I'm breathing in God and it makes me feel better. Yeah, but is it true or are you being led astray? Drugs will make you feel better for the moment, but it's not going to help you in the long run. So I said to him, really in astonishment, here's a pastor. I said, your Bible, like my Bible, says God dwells in a light that no man can approach unto, whom no man hath seen nor can see. God is spirit. Now how are you going to visualize yourself in the presence of this God? You may find, and I spoke very seriously and solemnly to him, I said, you may find to your sorrow, and I hope it will not be too late, that this beautiful new relationship and this stronger faith that you have arrived at, you think, is in fact based upon a fantasy you have conjured up in your own mind, and it will not stand the test when the time comes because it bears no relationship to reality. It's a product of your own imagination, and you have deceived yourself. I have a letter from a young man who wrote. He says, Dear Brother Hunt, I'm writing you to let you know that I endorse your book, Seduction of Christianity. Before I knew the Lord, I was a medium and fortune teller. Although I knew the visualization or use of the imagination method as conjuring, it was still the same thing that's being taught in the church today. Take it from someone who has been there. Jesus said, verse 45, because I tell you the truth, you believe me not. Verse 47, he that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because you're not of God. You don't become godly through visualizing God. In fact, that is absolutely forbidden. What did the demons, the masters of the Temple of Wisdom, teach Napoleon Hill to do? Well, they taught him to visualize 9 men from the past, and he sat them around a table in his imagination. Napoleon and Voltaire and Thomas Paine and Thomas Edison. He said, after a while, this scene became so vivid, they each took on their own personality, spoke with his own voice, each one. It frightened him, and he stopped doing it. He had demons sitting there. You see, a demon will take any mask you give them solely in a transmission from the other world, the spirit world, in a book that purports to have guidance from these loving entities on the astral plane. One of them named Soli says, we will appear to you in whatever form you believe in. Another one, Raphael, says, we will work with you, but only within the context of your present belief system. But we will lead you gently on in the direction we want you to go. But we don't make a big jump. If you want to visualize Jesus, we'll appear as Jesus. We'll appear as the Jesus like you think he looks. You know, they had Sun Myung-moon on the stand in New York in a trial. And he claims that Jesus appeared to him. And the lawyers on the other side were pretty sharp. And they said, well, when this Jesus appeared to you to give you this commission to unite the world in a new Christianity and so forth, how did you know it was Jesus? Sun Myung-moon says, I recognized him from his pictures. You've got to be kidding. They wanted to get that man, his lawyers wanted to get him off the witness stand quickly. But Rita Bennett in her book on inner healing, and we'll talk about inner healing in the next session, she says, visualize Jesus however your favorite artist pictures him. It doesn't matter how you see him. Calvin Miller in his book, Table of Inwardness, says, in my conversation with Jesus, I see him white-robed, yet at ease in my own time. I drink to the golden sun, the sunlight dancing in his golden hair, and you know, his blue eyes. And what? You disagree? His hair is black, his eyes are brown. Have it your way. Visualize him however you want, but you've got to have an image, because he says the visualized image is the key to vitality. That's where you get spiritual life from. And then he goes on to tell us bit by bit, block by imaginary block. He says the Bible writers did the same, and they visualized God and imagined him in their minds. So now we have a God who didn't reveal himself supernaturally, but men conjured him up in their mind, and we must do the same. And you are out on a fantasy trip that bears no relationship to reality. It may arouse tremendous feelings. There are some people who can't tell the difference between fantasy and reality. A lot of the young people who get involved in Dungeons and Dragons, some police have a question that they ask young people who are involved in bizarre behavior. Not just are you on drugs, but have you been involved in fantasy role-playing games? Because you can't tell the difference. And psychologists now tell us, isn't it wonderful that our subconscious mind can't tell the difference between reality and something that is vividly imagined? I'd say that that's something to mourn about and to try to correct. But they say, oh no, now you see what we can do. We can program ourselves and change ourselves, because your unconscious mind will believe any lie, no matter how fantastic, so long as you can visualize it and imagine it and make it real. So you can change the way you think by changing your perception of reality. It's not true. How do people visualize Jesus? Well, I had a call from a woman, a Christian leader in Southern California. She said, Dave, I've got some friends who are involved in silver mind control. I don't understand this silver mind control thing. I know it's a cult, but would you explain it to me so I know how to witness to them? I said, well, silver mind control is a powerful form of mind dynamics. And they'll teach you a lot of good things. You'll learn how to learn faster, how to memorize very quickly. But it's an occult technique, and it's so powerful that when you graduate from silver mind control, they will give you your money back. If you cannot accurately diagnose people that you've never even heard of, much less met, they will give you their name on a piece of paper, and you go into your alpha levels, your 10.5 cycles per second, you go into that laboratory that you've learned to visualize inside of you, you bring that elevator down, and out of that elevator walks two entities, male and female, the animus and the anima, from Carl Jung, and you visualize on a screen in your mind this person that you've never even met or even heard of. And she said, no, wait a minute now. See, I said at the heart of it is an occult technique called visualization. She says, well, now wait a minute, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. I hear that all the time. She says, I'm going to be leading a women's retreat this weekend. And I'm going to have the women visualize themselves in a beautiful landscape, and then visualize Jesus coming to them. And this Jesus will really do things. He will answer their questions. He will heal the meet their needs and solve the problems in their lives. What could be wrong with that? I said, if you've got 100 women visualizing Jesus, you've got 100 different Jesuses. Furthermore, they are all visualizing Jesus as they imagine he looked when he walked the dusty roads of Galilee. But my Bible says, Paul says, though we've known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. He has risen from the dead. And when John, who leaned upon his breast, the beloved who knew him intimately in close fellowship for 3 years, when he saw him as he is now, he fell at his feet as dead. I don't see people falling at their feet as dead, but they're visualizing a Jesus, maybe some of them in Levi's or in a robe or whatever, as they imagine he looked when he walked the dusty roads of Galilee, or they think he might look now in our time. It's not the real Jesus. You don't call from the right hand of the Father Jesus, the real Jesus, and he appears before you when you please. When Jesus appeared to his 10 disciples after his resurrection from the dead, it was a miraculous event initiated by him. They were behind locked doors for fear of the Jews, and suddenly there was Jesus in the midst. Doubting Thomas, who was not present that day, had to wait a week before Jesus came back in his own time and way, appeared to him and allowed him to put his fingers in the nail prints and so forth. Doubting Thomas felt embarrassed. He was repentant that he had not believed. And Jesus spoke to him words of comfort for you and me. He said, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." And Jesus was saying, it is even better not to see and to believe. If your faith depends upon some visible image, you are into idolatry. You're like the idolaters who couldn't believe in a God that they couldn't make a physical form for. Blessed are those who have not seen and believed, and yet there's an attempt to see through believing. It's an attempt to see him before his time. It's an attempt, the Bible says, we walk not by sight, but by faith. Visualization is an attempt to walk not by faith, but by sight. But Doubting Thomas had to wait a week until Jesus in his own time and way came. But we're being taught in the church today that Doubting Thomas need not have waited 5 minutes. All he had to do was visualize Jesus, and he would have had the real Jesus there anytime he wanted him. Now, in John 21, when Jesus appeared at the lakeside, you remember, and he gave them he had the coals there and the fish on them and so forth and bread. What does it tell us? It says, this is now the third time that Jesus appeared to his disciples. But you don't get the impression that they're conjuring him up whenever they wish. And when Paul writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he specifies he appeared to Cephas, first of all. Yes, Peter, who had denied him, and Jesus went and had a reconciliation time alone with Peter. He appeared to Peter, appeared to Mary, he appeared to the 12. He appeared to above 500 brethren at once. And then Paul says, and last of all, he appeared to me as of one born out of due time. You don't get the impression that Paul or anyone else is conjuring up Jesus in their minds and calling him from the right hand of the Father anytime they please. But this is what you're being taught. Either you have a fantasy Jesus who bears no relationship to reality, and it's a mind game you're playing, or you're getting the real Jesus. Or you're getting something else. And what concerns me the most is they get a spirit entity dressed up like Jesus as they want to see him, who begins to speak, who begins to move, who begins to do things. You have made contact with the spirit world. It's a shamanic technique, and it works, unfortunately, but it is not biblical. We're being taught in the Church of Jesus Christ today, this is a book, Dialogue with God, for example, by Mark Berkler. It comes out of Buffalo, New York, the Association for Church-Centered Bible Study, Bible Schools. Their curriculum teaches you how to enter into two-way conversation with God. Can you imagine that? It's a technique for getting in touch with God. And he tells you how it works. Here's a book for youth ministers. Spiritual Growth in Youth Ministry, it says. And somewhere here about page 70, he says, take a deep breath. He gives you a relaxation, a breathing technique that comes out of yoga. Then he says, next try to imagine God. Keep searching in your mind for however long it takes to form an image of God. Absolutely forbidden in the Word of God. I'm staggered. This is being sold in Christian bookstores. It's being believed in Christian churches and taught by Christian leaders. You say, but we're not into idolatry. We're not forming a god out of wood or clay or stone. Of course you're not. But every idol that was formed out of wood or clay or stone was first of all conceived in the mind. Some of you saw it in The Karate Kid, you remember? And when The Karate Kid met his master-to-be, he was trimming a bonsai tree. Those of you that saw the film, you remember? And he handed The Karate Kid some shears, and he says, "Here, you trim one too." The Karate Kid says, "I wouldn't know how to do it. I've never done it." Well, his master says, "All you do is look within. Whatever comes out of you is perfect. You look within and you find the tree inside. You visualize the tree inside. And then you paint, or you trim the tree out here to conform with the image that you saw inside." That's what you do in idolatry. You first of all conjure up a mental image, then you form the wood or the clay or the stone to agree with that. He says, don't worry if it takes a little time. After the image is clear, focus on it and fine-tune it by focusing on each part of the image and visualizing yourself with that image. But this is the most disastrous part. Eventually, it will speak to you. It will speak to you. Now you've conjured up an image that speaks. You've made contact with a spirit guide. And they're perfectly willing, if you give them the identity of Jesus or of God, you have given to a demon the ultimate masquerade, the ultimate lie. And now, believing that this is who it is, you begin to follow their directions. Now, not all visualization gets us so deeply into the occult. Some of it is simply, you're trying to set a goal. Those of you out in the business world, well, you got to have a goal in life. So, if you want to get ahead in life, you're starting out in a corporation, why don't you visualize yourself in the president's chair, in the president's office? See yourself as the president of that corporation. Some of you are getting this in Amway or various other courses like this. Well, supposing a half a dozen people are all visualizing themselves in the president's chair, and supposing the president doesn't want to retire just yet, you know? It becomes a mind game. You've got a bunch of Obi-Wans and Darth Vaders out there zapping one another with mind power, all to their own ends. In this book, Positive Imaging, Norman Vincent Peale tells you how he first learned this. They needed some money for their church. And one of his board members says, "You go out to Dr. So-and-so, I know he's a wealthy man, you ask him for $5,000. Dr. Peale said, "He wouldn't give it to him, he'll laugh at me." "Ah," says his board member, "I will visualize him writing out the check for you. And you go out and you ask him." And so Dr. Peale went and he asked the man, he laughed at him, said, "I'm not going to give you $5,000, why don't I give you $5,000? And then suddenly he says, "Something's coming over me. Well, maybe I will." And he pulled out his wallet and he wrote out a check for $5,000. Dr. Peale was ecstatic. He ran back to his board member and he says, he did it. He said, "Of course he did it. I sent a thought hovering over you and it hit him right between the eyes." Dr. Peale says, "I saw it hit him and it changed his thinking." And his board member says, "And it should change your thinking too." And Norman Vincent Peale says, from that day forth, visualization, active imagination, has been an integral part of all of my speaking and my writing. Now, there's something a little bit unethical about that, isn't there? I'm going to make people write out checks for me by visualizing them doing it. I'm going to impose my will upon people, and I'm going to impose my will upon God. And I'm going to play God, and I'm going to create my own world and my own universe in my mind, and God is going to have to sanctify it and honor it. People talk about a sanctified imagination. Well, I challenge you to tell me the difference between a sanctified imagination and just plain old imagination. There isn't any difference. And if it's a revelation from God, imagination is totally unacceptable and inapplicable. Here's a book written by the head of the largest and I guess the most highly regarded Christian charitable ministry in the world, and I certainly don't put them down for that. And I think he's a very sincere Christian. But listen to what he says. Everything that has ever been achieved started first as an unseen spark in a creative imagination. In the beginning, God created. God spoke into existence his imaginings. God was imagining, and then he spoke into existence his imaginings, and he created man in his image, and he gave man the power to achieve images. He says the potential for our imagination is unlimited. The untapped power of our imagination is unlimited. And now we must begin to visualize and create from our imagination like God did. If we just turn quickly, we run out of time here. Let's take just a few more minutes and turn quickly to Genesis chapter 11. And I think we can get some insights into what we've been talking about. You know the story well. These are the builders of the Tower of Babel. And verse 4, they said, "Go to, let us build us a city and a tower whose top may reach unto heaven." Ridiculous idea. I mean, nobody would take that seriously. You're going to build a city and a tower whose top will reach to heaven. You got to be kidding. Well, God took them seriously. And it says, God came down to see what they were doing in verse 5. And the Lord said in verse 6, "Behold, the people is one. They all have one language. And this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do." Wow. Oh, you say, well, I imagine like the cow jumped over the moon, I can just take a leap to the moon. Ridiculous. Not so ridiculous. When Neil Armstrong stepped out of that space capsule, he set a giant step for mankind. You know what the second thing was that he said? It's a little bit off of our subject. The second thing he said when he touched down, it's only a couple of inches deep. Oh, they had these huge things on the bottom, you know. They thought because the moon is billions of years old and evolution has been going on for billions of years, that this dust that's coming in from interstellar space will be, I don't know how many yards deep, and we're going to have to be careful we don't sink into it. We got big boots and so forth. And he stepped out and he said, it's only a couple inches deep. How do you like that? Maybe it's not as old as we try to say it is. But it was a giant step for mankind. When I was a boy and I read Buck Rogers and Flash Gordon, it was fantasy. Any of you here old enough to remember that, you know, we didn't believe it. I mean, it was science fiction. It would never happen. It was just in somebody's imagination. But it happened. Television, space travel, computers, everything that was once just in the imagination of man, man is able to accomplish it. But now, let's settle ourselves down. Lest we be lifted up with pride, your imagination is not infinite. You are not a creator. All you can do is take what God has created and shuffle it around in your imagination. That was one of the things that bugged Lenin, for example. Lenin realized, or he thought, that man is a stimulus-response mechanism. You touch something hot, you touch something cold, and after a while, you know, you begin like Pavlov's dog, and you're responding to stimuli out there. And you can't think of something that doesn't exist. You can think of pink elephants, but pink exists and elephants exist. Well, then Lenin said, where did the idea of for God come from? If we can only respond to stimuli out there in the world, what was the stimulus that created the response God in the human mind? And he couldn't solve that one to his dying day. Because God exists, and we know that he exists, and God has written this in every man's conscience. But your imagination is not infinite. If you think your imagination is infinite, then why don't you conjure up right now in your mind a new prime color for the rainbow? Can't do it. God created the rainbow and you can't improve upon it. Okay? But God was very concerned because man, eventually, with the ingenuity that God has given him, will be able to accomplish what he imagines. Well, that should be tremendous news for the human race. Why, we'll restore paradise. We'll turn this world into a place of peace and love and brotherhood. No. Why was God so concerned about the power of the imagination that people are telling us is good and wonderful? The first mention of imagination in the Bible, Genesis 6:5, God looked down upon this earth and he saw that the imagination of man's heart was only evil continually. What does Jeremiah say? The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. You're not going to search your own heart. Only God can do this. We need to get in touch with him. And Jeremiah said, I know that the way of man is not in himself. It is not in man that walketh to direct his steps. We need to turn from ourselves to him. But we are being turned from him to ourselves and to the power of our own minds. And God was concerned because the imagination is wicked, it's evil. Genesis 8 verse 21, evil from his youth. And if you turn to Jeremiah, and while you're turning there, let me just show you a couple of things as quickly as we can. This is a poster for the latest book of Marilyn Ferguson, who wrote The Aquarian Conspiracy. And jumping down past some of the rhetoric here, she says, in the information age on the brink of the quality of life revolution, in large print and small print it says, or Armageddon. Now you wouldn't be so negative as to believe in Armageddon. You wouldn't be a gloom and doomer as to believe in that sort of thing, would you? She says, we know that our choice lies in the power of human imagination. There's our hope, our ingenuity, our imagination. And then she says something that's incredible. She says, we created our way into the present circumstance. The way out, too, must be created. Yeah, we brought ourselves to the brink of ecological collapse. That's what we've done with our imagination. That's what we've done with our great technology. We're trembling under a nuclear sword of Damocles. No wonder God was concerned. If I went to a racetrack and I'd been on the same old nag day after day, week after week, that could hardly stagger out of the starting gate, never finish the race, you'd have good reason to believe that my loyalty to that horse far exceeded my common sense. And you're going to bet on the human race after what we have done on this earth? She says, we created it, we brought ourselves here, but the answer lies within us, within our imagination, with what the history of humanity, how we've destroyed this world, but we're still going to do it. You've got to be crazy to believe that. She says, we are not looking for salvation from God out here somewhere, but for an awakening. Not just a way out of Armageddon, but a way into life as we have always meant to live it. Oh, we don't need any help from God. We've got the power. And you know what happened? God scattered them knowing what would happen. He confounded their languages. And what are we doing in our day? We are the world. Unity is the big cry of our day. We're going to unite mankind. God scattered them and set the bounds of their habitations. Acts 17 says that they should seek the Lord, and happily they might feel after and find him. But we're going to unite one another to find ourselves. And what does that song, We Are the World, say? And we will turn stones into bread. What Jesus refused to do in submission to his Father's will, we are going to do it now by our own power. And we will create our paradise. Babel is revived. Babylon has been revived. And it's come into the church. That's what concerns me. We can do it, turning from him to ourselves, to our imagination. Notice what Jeremiah says, a couple of verses as we close. This evil people, which refuse to hear my words. Jeremiah 13, verse 10. Notice the contrast between words and imagination. We're being told today that visual imagery is much more powerful than words. We're being told that the human mind was even programmed by God to think in images, that when you're a little child growing up, you see a picture of a horse and then you see the word under it, and a car and you see the word under it. So when anybody says tree, you see a tree in your mind. But what do you see when we say justice, truth, love, understanding, comprehension? We are being robbed of the moral and spiritual content and the conceptual content of language by turning from words to imagination. And they'll say, but the Bible was written in visual, in imagery. Why, Psalm 91, for example, he will cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. Yeah, what are you supposed to do? Visualize God as a big bird? No. Even the visual imagery, the symbolic language in the Bible is not to encourage you to visualize. And the parables of Jesus were the barest skeleton on which to hang objective truth. We need understanding. And you don't understand from images. When God let the sheep down to Peter, Peter would not have known what that vision meant unless a voice had spoken to him and said, rise, Peter, kill and eat. And Peter says, I've never eaten anything unclean. What I have called clean, don't you call unclean. Peter, there are three men waiting at the door, and you go with them, nothing doubting, because I've sent them. He would never have known what it meant without the voice of God. You understand? A picture is worth a thousand words because you, from your imagination, supply the thousand words. But you don't know what the artist had in mind, and you don't communicate with pictures. The Bible was written in words. And the psalmist says, thy word is a lamp to my feet. Not your images. Thy word is a lamp to my feet, a light to my path. Jesus said to Satan, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Now notice what Jeremiah is saying. This evil people which refuse to hear my words, which walk in the imagination of their heart, and they walk after other gods. This is where it leads them. Notice Jeremiah 14, verse 14. Then the Lord said unto me, the prophets prophesy lies in my name. I didn't send them, neither spake I unto them, nor commanded I them. They prophesy unto you a false vision and divination and a thing of naught and the deceit of their heart. You want to know how new this is in the world? First World Conference on Imagery. When was it held? 20, 30 years ago? 1985 in San Francisco at the Gateway Holiday Inn. The Power of the Imagination, taught by Marquette University. Courses like this through psychology. We'll get more into this when we talk about psychology. Spreading around the world, being believed, and coming into the Church of Jesus Christ. And then people are getting involved in what they call journaling now. It's becoming very popular. You'll pick up books in your Christian bookstore. In journaling, you sit down and you begin to let your thoughts go, and then you write it down, and they tell you, God is communicating with us. You know, and I look back over it and I read the amazing wisdom of the thoughts that I had. It must have been the Holy Spirit guiding me. And now you think you're in communication with God when you're in communication with yourself. There's a book that's on the bestseller list right now in Christian bookstores called God Calling. And John Weldon puts it like this. He says, a demon makes the Christian bestseller list. It was written by two anonymous listeners, two women who learned to listen to God. And they said, the other people, they have to read the Bible, but we're in direct communication with God. And they wrote down some beautiful things. It sounds terrific, but it is not the inspired word of God. And when people say, thus saith the Lord, or I'm in touch with God, and they have a technique for developing this, Jeremiah 14, 14 applies. It is a false vision. It is the deceit of their own heart. God warns us about this. It's coming to the Church of Jesus Christ. It staggers me. I'm very concerned. I'm trying to warn people about it. Let's turn from ourselves back to Him. Let's surrender our lives and our hearts to Him. Let's let Him teach us. Don't conjure up and try to create a God after your own fashioning. But let's let Him mold us according to His will and into His image.